This is Hacking the Afterlife podcast with Jennifer Shaffer. Ho, ho, ho. Jennifer, how are you?
Merry Christmas. Happy holidays.
Oh, you're so sweet to say that. You know, here we are in Cyberland talking. Yeah. Ho. I got Santa over my shoulder keeping an eye on people.
It is. So there's so much to talk about. First of all, for the audience, Richard sent me a card. Richard's card's on the way, but we picked the exact same card. Out of hundreds of thousands of cards you could pick from, you and I have the exact same card, just with a different color.
Oh, how funny. How weird is that? Great minds think alike.
I started laughing. I thought that was the funniest thing ever. So 21 years ago, I gave my husband a Valentine's card that I gave him way in advance. Like, I picked it out, took my time. He, of course, now, because he buys them on the same day, picked up the same exact Valentine's card that I did.
I picked mine up,
it was just very sweet. And I was just laughing. I'm like, I love that you and I, out of all the Christmas cards, and I've looked at my history, I haven't sent one. I kind of feel like we should talk about it a little bit, since my dad passed. Like, yeah. It's been heartbreaking for me, because this actually today, 5 years ago, 6 years ago, we found out my dad was dead. And then he died a month later. And so holidays bring such a, it's mixed. And what I really want to tell people is you can grieve and still be happy. And it's okay if you don't get your cards out. It's okay if you don't, you're not Christmassy Christmas or whatever. This year, I had my whole house decorated by December 2nd. That never happens. I got my cards out, which hasn't happened since my dad passed. I have realized it's painful for people that miss their loved ones, but you need to, actually, I can say this because she listens to our podcast. She found our podcast, Jessica Alba. We're dear friends. And it was very sweet. She Googled somebody that we talked to, and our podcast showed up on Spotify. I didn't know that we were on Spotify, so that was good. Found out that we were on Spotify.
Cool.
She was so excited about it. She goes, Jennifer, it was so sweet. So she was very sweet this last weekend. She had a group of us come to her house, and she had a sound bath. Somebody do a sound bath and breath work.
What's a sound bath, by the way?
It is a beautiful thing that energetically, if you can think of, how you told me, how the rain, when my dad passed, you said, think of rain cleansing. Think of the rainfall. You took me through this whole thing to talk to my dad. I'll never forget it. And that kind of came in.
I did forget it. I'm sorry, but that's brilliant. I love that I said that.
You did say that. And so when a sound bath, you mentioned a sound bath, it's like cleaning your energy, and it makes you feel so good. It's just that you just think of bathing in it, like light.
So does somebody?
It's like frequencies. So
no, but I mean, does somebody lead you through it? Is there somebody standing up? Does Jessica Alba? Does she lead you through it?
She just had it. She's the person that got everybody there.
Oh, I see.
She's so sweet. She's so giving and so kind. I'm not just saying that. She really is, and she knows I'm reluctant because. She's like, you don't receive. I'm like, what are you talking about? I'm fine. During the breath work, I couldn't breathe. Does breath work and can't breathe because of your heart? Because I'm so afraid of allowing, because of what I deal with when I deal with content. I'm dealing with parents that don't have their children. I'm dealing with, finding a missing body, finding somebody that's. So I've had this shield. And she's seen it, and she just laughs about it. She's like, I think you need your heart to be a little bit more. I'm like, no, I don't.
More open.
Meanwhile, I'm choking over breath work. I can't breathe. And what I learned from that was the fact that I don't ask for help. I'm not somebody to ask for help.
Well, you know, it's interesting also in terms of your dad, bless his heart, Jim. We've been so fortunate to have him come and talk to us a few times. You know, I wasn't really aware, even though I've known you for 8 years, I really wasn't aware of that whole process. I know you told me, and then I, you know, I don't think we had seen each other for a while. And then when he would show up, even before you would say anything, I could see the tears in your eyes. And then you'd change the subject. You'd say, you know, I feel like we need to change the subject. And at first I let that go. And then there was one day we were doing a session and the tears showed up. And I said, can we ask your dad, is there any way that he can help us with grief? And that forced you to ask him a question that you didn't know the answer to, because clearly you were going through it yourself. And we've mentioned it on the podcast. He said, try to move grief to nostalgia. And I remember I said, what does that mean? And you looked at me and said, I don't know what it means. And I thought, okay, well, he's here, so can we ask him? Anyway, it's happening again. I can see the tears. But, you know, your dad was so generous. He came and he said, grief is only sad memories. Nostalgia has both happy and sad memories. And if you can move grief to nostalgia, you begin the healing process. It's not a cure-all, but it begins. So if you can remember when they made you laugh, you can remember, especially around the holidays. I'd say to people, and we've talked about this, bring out a photograph. Put your picture of Uncle Pete.
Yeah, so that was what I was going to say. So Jessica was, and she doesn't mind me saying this. She said to me, she's like, bring out a photograph, bring out, like, get, she goes, you and Rich talked about it. She goes, bring out a chair for them to sit with you during the holidays. And, and it was just like, I forget, of course, I love that everything's recorded, but I forget we tell people that. And I just feel like, you know, I actually thought this month is going to be amazing and I don't feel the grief, but now my mom's in the hospital.
Oh, I'm sorry.
It's okay. She's better. She had a ventilator. Now I'm getting another thing. She's off the ventilator. They had to drain her lungs. She has congestive heart failure. And so at the same, I'm like, really, at the same time we found out my dad had pancreatic cancer, it felt like it just came right back, you know. Right.
Everything came back.
And so I want our audience to know, everyone who misses someone, it is okay to feel bad. Allow yourself to feel bad, but also allow yourself to be happy at the same time. We feel like we can't do both.
Yeah.
And I can grieve, but I can still, you know, go out with friends that I want to see or with family. I can't wait to be with my family this weekend. I am so lucky. I have the most beautiful family that has been there for my mom.
That's great. Yeah.
But, you know, when you have one passing away and then somebody else that's sick or you have another person passes away, it just brings everything all up to the surface, right?
Right.
Like everything. And so I think a lot of people just need to know that you're loved from the other side. They don't want you to feel like, they don't want you sad. They want you to be happy. Honor them the way that you can, but also honor yourself. Like, that's the one thing I've learned from Jessica. Like, I don't want to be, I'm like, what do you mean I have a heart issue? Like, she knows. I'm like, what? But it was true. I'm afraid I'm going to break, and it's okay to be broken a little bit. It's not
wow. That's pretty profound. It's okay to be broken.
It's okay to be broken.
Because you know what they say, when something's broken, that's where the light comes in. You know, the cracks are when light comes in. So you learn stuff. You can't learn anything if everything's always good all the time. You can learn stuff, especially about your loved ones. You know, let's say that you set the table for them, or you allow them to come into your awareness over the holidays. You toast them in present tense. And maybe you go around the room and ask somebody to tell a story about somebody who can't be there. That's always very revelatory, because you hear stories about people you never heard before.
Like your brother when we were at his memorial.
Oh, yeah. My brother who passed away this past year. And at the memorial, there were all these wonderful stories about him that I had never heard before. And, you know, we just did it as a technique, sort of let's talk about my brother Jeff in present tense. Because, look, you and I know that he's there, that he's capable of hearing us. Everyone in the room didn't know that, but just telling a story about his journey or his life or silly things that he would say or do. I think I remember somebody read a letter that one of my cousins had written, and how when he was a young guy, my brother had shown up at his work and given him such a thing of, you know, you're going to be great. I really appreciate what you're doing. You know, just keep going. And it would change his life, as he said. So I'd never heard that before. So that thing of asking your loved ones to come forward, as well as asking people in the room to talk about them or to tell a story, or you're raising a toast while you're saying the toast. Let's toast so-and-so in present tense. Has anybody got a good story about Uncle Pete or Aunt Betty? And if everyone gets quiet, you know it's time to get on to the toast, right?
So, right.
Well, you know, about this time, every day, we ask our friend Luana Anders to come forward. She's our moderator on the flip side, who helps us do this podcast. Lou, we're grateful for your presence. And does she want to bring anybody forward? I think Jim might be here. Does Jim want to talk to us?
Sorry.
It's okay. It's allowed.
Thank you. Another thing, when you're so close to something, and I have such PTSD from thinking I could save my dad, right?
Yeah.
And on Tuesday, it was actually touch and go with my mom, and they didn't know if she was going to make it. And I got that, you know, initially I got that she would, but, you know, my mind will never trust it because of my dad passing. One of the hardest thing I've ever heard was my son telling me, he's like, I hope so many people, how could you not know that our grandpa had cancer? How could you not know? And he didn't mean it away. And I'm sorry.
That's quite all right, Jennifer. I remember you telling me that sentence. I have to apologize. I have a bad cough. I've had it for about a week and a half now. And it's really annoying because I'll pop a cough drop and then slurp all the way through. But, you know, when we examine our path and journey, I know that, but, you know, look, the thing is, when we talk about mediumship, I mean, I talk about a lot on Quora. We talk about how, you know, mediums filters, their filters are altered. Everybody has filters on the brain that block out information that's not conducive to survival. That could include being aware of things that are about to occur that would stop you from living your life or doing the work you're doing. And it's almost like on the flip side, they're aware of what's going on. Your higher self is aware of what's going on and will block that information, even from mediums who see everything or see or experience much.
We're not supposed to know everything. Otherwise, we have lottery numbers. And people always say that, like, I'm like, it's interpretation. So they're not giving you, like, it's numbers. It can be skewed, but whatever. But another thing that was very powerful, too, with all of this, like I told some, I mentioned that my mom was in the hospital. And a very sweet friend of mine, Uni, she's like, I'll pray for her. I pray for everyone at 6 a.m. I will pray for her. I'll put her on a prayer list. The power of prayer collectively, it's not, I know there was a lot of people praying for my dad, but the power of prayer is so big. It's such a big thing, that energy of sending, however prayer looks, whether it's chanting, whether it's praying, whether it's however it looks, you know, it ties in with faith and hope. It doesn't mean, you know, I'm looking at God in the sky, but I see Santa Claus behind you. It's kind of the same thing. I feel like, you know, when Luana came in, she just said, everything's going to be okay. And that's when
thank you, Lou. I appreciate that.
With however it looks, you know, and it's,
oh, well, yeah, there's that. Every, you know, when sometimes when they come forward and they give you, look, I just interrupted you, and somebody complained that I interrupt you all the time, but that's my job. No. But that idea of them coming forth and saying everything is going to be okay is a very profound statement, because it doesn't mean, you know, difficult things won't happen. It means that you got to remember that the path, eventually, everything's going to be okay. Everyone goes home. Everyone, when they get home, everyone, all of us. And when we get home, we realize why we were on the path and the journey.
Cat.
That's a cat agreeing with me.
But not just that, because I took a screenshot as I was typing to you. Robert Town called. And I was before you said this, and the cat just confirmed it, we need to talk about animals. Animals go through what you go through in life, right? They are with you. They're meant to be, you know, they're just as much, even if you don't have children, which sometimes I'm envious, but even if you don't have children and you have animals, celebrate them as well over the holidays. Cause I know how hard, how challenging it is as well. Like, I'm sure the reason why Robert called me, he misses Hira. Hira in the afterlife, right?
No, for those people who aren't aware of the podcast so much, Hira is the only dog that's been nominated for an Oscar as a screenwriter. The movie Greystoke, Robert used his name as a pseudonym. And Robert Town, the guy who wrote Chinatown, I worked for him for a number of years. I was telling him about this research, and he was a typical skeptical person, was like, oh yeah, sure. And so I said, well, let's try it with Jennifer. And he did. And his dog Hira came through, clear as a bell, talked about things that only Hira could know, and proved to Robert beyond a shadow of doubt for him that Hira still exists. So today I said, because he called me right after he called you, I was telling him about our podcast a couple of weeks ago, where we spoke to Queen Elizabeth, Princess Diana, and Hira. Hira came through and just wanted us to remind Robert that he's always with him. And Robert said to me today, I wish I could see him or hear him. And I said, well, you know, before you go to sleep at night, imagine him sitting with you, or imagine walking with him in the woods or somewhere in the grass. And allow that to be your state of being. And perhaps the dream will pick up from there and you go forward. And that's a way of connecting to everyone that's not on the planet, is before you go to sleep, invite them to have a conversation.
Yeah.
And you wake up the next day, you know, write it down or come on our podcast. So Lou, Iris ran through the room. So Luana, is there anybody on your guest list, your VIP list that we're
that she always comes through with dreams for you, and she wants it. Did you do like a past life thing where you felt like you did a past life thing in your sleep last night?
I have had some pretty unusual. It's funny because you know, just as the dream is ending, I was thinking to myself, oh, this might be for the podcast. But then I can't remember who I was talking to, what it was about.
She's going to help you remember.
Okay. So, Luana, was I with some person last night?
It was almost like a movie, like not the Grinch. Hold on.
Movie like the Grinch or not like the Grinch?
No, like I'm being shown Okay, who's okay? You have to show me who's the one that wrote about what is his name? Sorry.
Well, give me the image.
I'm getting the image of me in London going to his house.
Oh, Charles Dickens.
That's it. Sorry. Thank you.
Santa, right over my shoulder. We did have a conversation with Charles Dickens, which I'm sure Jennifer doesn't remember.
No, I don't, because I didn't even remember
well,
his name.
Well, Luana, is that who wants to come and talk to us today?
Yeah.
Okay, so. Very good. Let's not judge it. And by let's, I mean everybody listening in from across the planet who's rolling their eyes or driving off the road. So, Mr. Dickens, would you mind taking a seat with our class today? I know we've talked before. First, sir, what is it you want to say? I have questions for you, but go ahead. What do you want to say?
Christmas is an emotional time. That's why I wrote about it. He's showing me, like, it brings every feeling and emotion of possibilities. Because when you're a kid, you're like, oh my God, you know, think about when you're a kid, like, you get Christmas gifts.
Well, and also, I understand what he's saying. It brings everything. I interrupted you again. Sorry. But I just want to ask him, is he referring to also the diaspora of Christmas in terms of money, in terms of how there are wealthy people who celebrate it in a certain level, and then those are impoverished, the servants?
So he showed me that because I told my kids this year, I said, you're 18, you're 20. Your gifts need to go to a family in need. So I want you guys to pick charities. We'll do it in your name, but we're going to donate what we'd normally, you guys never go without. You get everything you want all year round. We're going to the Bahamas next week. Like, you're very fortunate. And I'm like, I'm one of seven children, and my dad still, every year, we would donate to a family that didn't have anything. I'm like, we did that when they were younger through their school or whatever. But yeah, so talking about that, listen, we came to an agreement. They're giving half of their presents away.
Very good. Negotiate.
Negotiate.
So, Charles, I think just something about your work that is underappreciated. I know that you were you wrote politically about the people of the era, the politicians, the people who took money from the poor. I know that you grew up on a street or lived near one of those workhouses, they were called. We call them poor houses, where impoverished people would die of starvation. Literally, children that were orphans were put into these Victorian blocks of homes.
Tony Stockwell,
yeah. And in the book, Architecture of the Afterlife, he recalled a lifetime living in that era and dying from starvation. But it reminded me, of course, of Oliver Twist. And in this tale, let's just talk about the most famous story, which I know that people would line up at the docks for when the ships would drop off the magazine, because he wrote Christmas Carol in installments. So people would go down to the docks in Boston, different cities, wait in line like a mile long to get the next issue. Most people don't know that about him. And he went to visit somebody that I'm a fan of, Washington Irving, who had written ghost stories, the first ghost story writer in American history. He wrote The Legend of Sleepy Hollow. And Dickens went to visit him. Now, let me ask you, Charles, do you remember doing that, or is that?
Vividly, he says.
Say again?
He said vividly.
Vividly. Now, and let me ask you a silly question, if you don't mind, sir. Washington Irving had an uncle who lived in his home. He lived in the living room, and he brought his family to live at Irving's because there was like a depression going on. So he had like 10 children in this home. It's one home on the Hudson. Do you recall the name of this uncle? His first name was quite unique, and it's related to Christmas Carol.
I don't know. Like, you say Bob's your uncle.
Bob's your uncle. Yeah, his name is Bob. Ebenezer was his name.
I would not have ever.
You wouldn't. Well, you know, I figured he may have remembered that. I don't know. So I was wondering if Ebenezer Scrooge, because Washington Irving's uncle was a banker who lived and was like a curmudgeon who lived in the house. I thought, I wonder if that's a. So who was Ebenezer Scrooge in your world when you created him as a writer? Who was that? Just show Jennifer an image of somebody you knew, or was it just an amalgam?
Not like his dad.
More related to your father. Kind of curmudgeonly, is that correct?
Yeah.
Okay. Someone that's allowed.
But, what? Hold on. He's saying it was related to his father, but it was connected to his dad. So it was connected to his dad and it felt like politics. So it felt like it was like I'm being shown the presidency, like it's something about that.
Yeah. And so there were politicians in London who were, you know, taking money away from the poor or, right, okay. You know,
right. You said
the royalty, the royal family, that yeah. Sort of thing. Because he was really about, and you know, industrialism had taken over England at the time, and like some other writers, felt that was destroying humanity in a way, let's say. Is that true in your book, A Tale of Two Cities? What's an image you can put in Jennifer's mind when I say that?
He just put a big gate up. Like he put a huge gate, like keeping people out, like a big, one of those big gates that, you know, like the palace.
Yeah, or like Citizen Kane. You know, Xanadu, there's a big, huge gate between the people and then the royalty, the people trying to get into the... Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah, because it feels dark. Hold on. Okay, hold on. Give me a second.
Sure.
It just felt like everything that had to do with the Depression.
Okay, very good. And there was a depression, a financial depression in London while he was writing A Christmas Carol. Let me ask you this, and Jennifer and I are aware that this is a possibility. Are you aware, Jennifer, have you seen the film Spirited? Okay.
Yes. Yes.
You have. Okay, very good. You have seen it.
You know I'm obsessed with Ryan Reynolds. It's an unhealthy relationship that I have.
You did mention that. You did. You told us to go see it. And I did. And I loved it too. I thought it was great.
I loved it. People either loved it or loved it. Sorry.
Well, they let's ask Charles. Opinion, please.
Inspired it. He says that he inspired it somehow.
I know you inspired it. Hello. But what did you think of the movie? Have you seen it?
He doesn't like singing.
He doesn't like singing.
Musicals.
Okay. That's funny. Is he kidding? Is he teasing? Or is he just being honest?
He's totally kidding. He said Will Ferrell had a huge, like, he showed me he had, like, big pants to fill for this role. Like, it was a big thing. And he says that he did it, excellently. It was excellently done.
Very good. Because, you know, Jack Nicholson, I think, had played him. Bill Murray had played him. I'm sorry, no. Quite a few actors have played his role. And to give Will Ferrell that kind of credit.
Yeah, he said that Will Ferrell was able to connect with so many different audience levels, like so many different, you know, age groups, I guess, with that. It wasn't just, I don't know. Hold on. He did an excellent job. He says.
And in terms of the story of how it works out with Tiny Tim, I mean, there is something in that film.
That's hilarious about the whole Tiny Tim thing.
Well, in this version of it, they had some fun with the idea of the cliche that it has become where, you know, they're trying to fix Tiny Tim. And, you know, the whole idea is that a few money, some money, you know, and a Christmas turkey is going to fix the kid's life. But so what was it like for you to have that kind of acclaim in your career? Because people went nuts for this story. Was that satisfying?
He just took what he saw and made it come to life, he says.
Very good.
It was sadness. He said sadness. So, you can't change.
Yeah.
Hold on. Give me one
second. Go ahead. Sorry.
You can't change the outcome, but you can change what you do within it. So like, he's saying like during the depression, so the depression's happening. You can't change the depression, but you can change how you go above it or how you help people within it. And that's why, you know, like with me, he showed me, you know, with what I told my kids, I'm like, listen, we're going to give for Christmas. This is what Christmas is about. I don't want you to think it's just receiving. You guys need to know that there's so many families that need help, right? Sure. Or so many kids or whatever. He's like, it's how you handle it. And like, and then I was showing my dad, like my dad, we didn't, you know, he had 7 children, but we still managed to give families that didn't have as much as we did. You just do it. You do what you can. It doesn't mean you have to give things. You might give them your time. You might give them a phone call, like an elderly parent, a phone call. You might go visit an aunt that hasn't been visited or whatever it is, or go to a dog shelter or an animal shelter, you know,
and walk the animals, because, you know, no one's there to walk them. So if you go to an animal shelter of abandoned pets, they'll let you walk that dog. And so you have a little bond between you and this animal that's going to go back there. But you're right. Just given a little of your time and self to let them know that somebody cares.
He believes that he changed the way people did things because of that story.
Say that again, please.
He believes by bringing truth out in that story, he was able to change a lot of hearts within it.
And still to this day. Because, yeah. You know, I think it's one of the most remade films and, you know, stories in history. Let me ask you, when you crossed over, who was there to greet you?
Oh. It feels like a child of his. As you know, I don't know.
I don't know. But a child who had passed away?
Somebody that had, like, I'm feeling like the ears.
Who were you surprised to see when you crossed over?
Stop. Oh, my gosh. He's so funny. He's like my unicorn.
What does he mean by that?
I don't know. Hold on. Unicorns are real.
Well, do they exist outside of our planet? They could exist in another realm.
Mm-hmm.
So when you say my unicorn, was this a unicorn you had met or seen before?
It was my dog when I was here, but it was a unicorn somewhere else.
On the flip side. Ah, interesting. So his dog didn't show up as a dog. Mm-hmm. Showed up as a unicorn.
But he knew it was his dog.
He was able to recognize him. Let me ask you. Oh, go ahead.
No, I have the chills. I love that.
It's brilliant. So, have you seen Washington Irving?
Of course. We're writing together, he says.
All right. And so let me ask you, Charles, you know that I'm working on a Washington Irving story. Is this something I should continue? Well, Jennifer doesn't, but you do, Charles, and Washington knows.
That's why he said he was here.
To encourage me or to discourage me?
To encourage you.
You never know. They could be saying, you know, drop that.
Right, but what's interesting is that now it makes sense why he came through, but he says that that was part of your dream. You had a dream that was.
Oh, okay. It's very possible. I could have, but it's very possible. Because I've been thinking about it lately. It's something that I pitch to a movie studio and they bought it. And then things changed. The people in the studio left. So it's sort of back in my lap. Listen, what an unusual way to have a story conference. Charles Dickens is in the room. So let me ask you, Charles, no music in this one? Is that what you're saying? Or music is okay?
Music is great.
Music is great. I swear to God, if I had my thing, I could show you. I could show you in my calendar this morning, looking at a note that is about a dream. Okay, you can't really read that, but it says, "Dream, make this story by Washington Irving a musical."
I win.
I saw that this morning. And I was like, oh, yeah, I made that note. The heck does that mean? I've got sorry, my cough.
I know. Here,
I have cough syrup.
You need
drugs. Go ahead. You're up. Go ahead.
Okay, I'm up. I just love the fact that it came full circle. They talked about your dream. They talked about what you're supposed to, and then you, at the end of our conversation with Charles Dickens, he showed me in London. I'm like, but I didn't know, you know, that's the only way they could show me. And now they're very excited about what you're doing.
Wow. That's wow. Yeah. What a thing to hear. How much more time do I have with you, Jennifer?
Not much.
Okay. So Charles, let's talk about your journey now. Have you come back to the planet since then?
Hell no.
And why not, pray tell?
Hold on. He says there's a part of me that's there.
Oh, and what percentage, if you don't mind me asking?
Stop. Hold on. Okay, just remind me to tell you what he showed me.
Just naughty? Something naughty? Is that what you're saying?
No, but I just want to say it on air.
Oh, okay. It's all right. That's allowed. You know, we don't mind. Charles, what do you want to tell people about their holiday season, please? Love.
Love yourself. Stop. It's with Jessica Alba. You don't receive love. Love yourself and find a space for people that are here, that are over there, that just need to be heard. Like he said, lend an ear. You know, Christmas cards are great because it's something that you think. I still cannot believe we have the same Christmas card.
That is too funny. And by the way, let me just, Charles, if you don't mind.
Hold on. I got to show.
Okay. Oh my God, it's the same card. That's hilarious. It's identical.
It's identical.
Okay. Of course, that is Shutterfly, and we picked the same pattern, but still.
Thousands of different patterns. That's nutty.
That is nutty. I thought you were kind of like kidding, but now you're not. It's identical. Oh, wait a minute. Do I have it? No, I don't have it.
Sure's everything.
I have sent mine out. I would show it if I could. Let me ask Luana. So Luana, I got to mention this because you were the best Christmas card giver I've ever met in my life. And I got a email from my brother. Can you see that?
A little bit, but not really. Because you're.
See? Oh.
Yes.
All right. It's the same card, but it's backwards. There you go. Anyway. My brother sent me an email the other day, and Luana had sent my brother Robbie a baseball bat, a Louisville Slugger, with his name engraved on it. And my brother, who was a baseball freak and a fan his whole life, couldn't believe that she had done that. Somehow, she had figured out how to call the guys who make baseball bats, a Louisville Slugger, and had his name engraved on a bat like it was his own model. And he just sent it to me the other day. He was like, I just remember this is the greatest gift I've ever gotten in my life. And he said, I don't know how Luana knew baseball was so important to me. But so Lou, do you want to say anything about that?
She said that you just do what you do. And she knew that he would love it. And it's because she loved you. And what was also very sweet, she just showed me this. So I've been watching movies with my daughter. And like, we're going to watch all the old school movies that probably could never get made today, like 16 Candles, Hell. But we've talked to the person that wrote 16 Candles. Don't you have a relative that's married to some, like?
My brother, Robbie, who's baseball bat, his wife was best friends with John Hughes and his wife, Nancy Hughes. And she was with him when he passed away in New York City. Her and her daughter, who was working as assistant.
That came up today. Any John Hughes movie we're watching, because I love, I'm like, wait, I've talked to him before.
Yeah, that's right. Planes and Trains and Automobiles. That's one of his movies, too. A prolific artist, John Hughes. Bless his heart. We miss him. And, of course, I went to he went to school with my brother. And I went to school with one of the Buellers, the younger brother of the Ditch King. Yeah, it was A.C. Bueller was the guy that I went to school with. And he was the brother of the famous Ditch King, the guy who always got out of school and got away with it. You know, it was a documentary. It's not just a comedy film, because that is the story. Bueller. Mm-hmm. All right. Jennifer, tell me.
I know. I have to go, but
first, let's tell you that we love you. We love that Jim comes through. We hope your mom recovers fully, because she has a lot more laughs to give. And I'd love to see her. I haven't seen her in a blue moon. She's so adorable. Like her daughter.
Please listen to all your books. Like, I send all my clients your book. Like, I love your books. I love what you've done. Someone actually mentioned that we need to put all our podcasts in a book.
That's funny. Yeah, it's like, you know, okay, but they're here. They're online. You can find them. You know, you can just click on them. Anyways, thank you so much for your gifts. And thank you so much for bringing Charles Dickens together with our listeners today. What an unusual podcast, and very apropos for the holiday season. And for those out there tuning in who are suffering from a loss of a loved one, listen to what Jennifer was trying to say. Love yourself first, then speak to them in present tense, allow them to come forward and tease you and have some fun with you while you're honoring them over the holiday season. We love you.
Love you too. Love you lots. Merry Christmas. Happy holidays. Happy Hanukkah. Kwanzaa.
Happy Hamana. Happy Hamana, Hamana, Hamana.
Your production.
All right. Very good. Love you. Bye. This has been Hacking the Afterlife podcast with Jennifer Shaffer. For more information, jennifershaffer.com, martinizone.com, or richmartini.com. Hacking the Afterlife documentary is available on Gaia.com via Amazon Prime.